Hello, folks. Just to let you know, in about 5 minutes, I'm going to be starting this stream. So sit back and give me a couple more minutes to prep, and we'll be on our way. Thanks for joining me today. Hello, folks. I'm getting started now. Thanks for joining me. And today, excuse me as I move stuff around. Today, I'm going to be drawing something on the Zika virus. And still getting set up a little bit. But thank you for joining me. I see we've got a few people here. Let me turn up my brightness just a little bit, and I think we'll be ready to go. Oh, that's better. That's better. No audio? Audio not working? Is it working? You hear me? Audio works for Ginger and Juice. Nice to see you, Lily Bean and Ginger and Juice. You guys are good, loyal regulars. I appreciate that. Thank you. Okay, so today, I'll show you what I've got here. This is an old cartoon I did on the SARS virus. Remember when that was big news? SARS virus? So I'm going to draw a mosquito with his suitcase that has the places that he's been, and I think I might make him hitchhiking. So it's an excuse to draw a big mosquito, which seems like the most obvious thing that you would do about Zika virus. It's got to be like a Yahtzee cartoon. There's probably a dozen people that have drawn it, but I haven't happened to have seen it, and it's fun to draw, so I'll go on that, and if you see somebody else who drew one, you can let me know, and I'll say, oh, but because it seems so obvious, but what the hell. Hello, Fancy Schmancy TV, nice to see you here. Okay, so let's get started on this. This is basically going to be a redo of my old SARS cartoon, except that it's the mosquito, and he's traveling around. So here I've got this web page from the Centers for Disease Control, which shows the countries that have problems with the Zika virus. And I can choose from among these what stamps to put on the mosquito suitcase. And let's see, I think, did I get a page of mosquito images? I need to know what mosquitoes look like, so let's see. There's that window. Do I have mosquitoes? Countries with mosquitoes? I'll try Chrome. Did I do search for mosquitoes? I thought I did a search for mosquitoes. Nope. All right, let's do a search for mosquitoes. Zika mosquitoes images. Nice to have you lurk here, Fancy Schmancy. All right, images of Zika mosquitoes. Well, this is what I'm going to be looking at as I draw this hitchhiking mosquito. Ugly bastards. Interesting, the white spots. It seems to be something about the Zika mosquitoes in particular. It's these white spots that I haven't much thought about. Oh, in case you're a regular here, if you watched my video two or three cartoons ago, I drew the Supreme Court vacancy. And here it is in my local paper, which is kind of fun. This is, you know, this is the goal of these cartoons, that they end up in the local paper. Somebody's local paper, everybody's local paper. Anyway, I thought that was... I still enjoy seeing my cartoons printed in the paper. Hello, John Waters Jr. Nice to see you here on YouTube. Yeah, you know, Lily Bean, Ginger Juice. Ultimately, you do this because it's fun to see your stuff in the paper and get the responses, and so I'm enjoying doing these videos as well. I'd like to have more of an audience, but I appreciate you regular folks. I mean, not regular folks, folks who are regular visitors. So thank you so much, Lily Bean, Ginger and Juice, Fancy Smancy, John Waters, for being here. And please have some stuff to say so that I'm not completely speechless. Okay, Mosquito. Well, let's think for a minute. I don't have things well organized. You'd think with that clock running for 15 minutes, I'd get well organized. So, if I'm drawing a regular guy hitchhiking, he's looking back in that direction. And he's got his hand with his thumb out. Like that. And he's got his suitcase here. And his body weight has to be a little bit behind because he's got the weight of his arm sticking out and his suitcase hanging him down here. That is a hitchhiker, okay? So if he's a mosquito hitchhiker, what happens then? Well, he's got a little head down here with his buggy eyes and his needle nose. And then he's gonna have his hunchback in his body with his blood sac over here, right? Maybe that's the way his body goes. Section there. Okay, he's got arms holding his suitcase like that, let's say. And then his legs are like that, wings like that, hitchhike hand like that. All right, I guess I can do that. He's a bit obscured by his suitcase, so he's kind of ran that way. So, all right, I think I got it. I'm trying to figure out my mosquito anatomy because, you know, typically I'm not thinking of mosquito anatomy. I have another nice glass of Flint, Michigan water. So I'm all set on my day today. All right. Draw in a hard pencil first. See all these little marks on my table are for when I break through my crummy paper with my drawing too hard with my pencil. Okay. So I want to fill my 1.5 wide by 1 tall drawing area. Focal point has to be his face. So I don't think I can go with a head that's actually as small as this mosquito head is. Oh, did I want to do that? Zika virus. Okay, there he is. Interesting, those white spots. It's like somebody came with a paint and just did a little bit of decoration on there. A kid. Well, ugly bastard. All right. So back to me. Now that you know what I'm looking at. So I'm making his head bigger than it should be, I guess. The face is where the expression is. is harder to draw than I thought. Oh, it's got hair on its middle section, doesn't it? And the wings are short. And it's got some nasty antenna. I'm going to give it nice curly antenna. Okay, maybe I need some perspective. Oh, no, you got that nice break on its head. The teeny little neck before it goes to this, which is kind of nice. Can't really see what the eyes look like. Some hair on its head, too. Okay. Kind of goes into a neck. Figuring out friggin' mosquito. Okay, from this central body part, all the legs come out of this before it goes to that big blood bag on the back. Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't know how to draw this. Okay, there's this hitchhiking hand. These legs have multiple joints. 1, 2, 3 joints per leg. Ooh. That's how I make marks on my table. The legs emanate from the bottom of this gizmo. You really want them to have, I guess arms have 1, 2. We're short a joint. Come down there. Maybe this arm needs to come out even more to make him wider, huh? He could have a backpack. What do you think? Should he also have a backpack? Nah, doesn't need a backpack. Doing a little bit of guessing here. My mosquito anatomy could be better. Let's put his hitchhiking hand down a little lower. I'm gonna pull his body down this way. Okay, then you need a leg that goes up like that. I can give him a mosquito foot that way.
Well, that's kind of all right, I guess. Then he's got another foot on the other side that goes down this way to his mosquito feet.
Funky Monkey writes, Daryl, I've just popped in briefly, but just to let you know that you need to change the stream title, which says The Supreme Court and Apple, two cartoons for me today, unless you're doing that again. All right, let's change that. Okay, there, I just changed it on Twitch. What do you think? Changed it on, Okay, got it changed on YouTube too. Thank you, Funky Monkey. I appreciate that. One thing that you do with feet to make them look like feet is that you have them go back a bit for the heel. That's something a lot of beginning cartoonists don't do. They forget their heels, they draw the bottoms of feet like little L's at the bottom of stick figures, and that doesn't look quite right. Okay, those two big legs. So he could have another hand on his suitcase as well, couldn't he? Two hands on the suitcase, so one hand there, other hand here. That's kind of funny, two hands on the suitcase. How many legs does he have? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Okay, thank you, Funky Monkey. See you soon. Appreciate the advice on those titles. Yes, I have too many things on my checklist of stuff to do before I start streaming. Blend. Okay. You know, the wings are surprisingly crummy looking wings. Nose can be a little nastier, I guess. Okay. He can have a arm on his hip. Just hang in there, they make a little more sense, huh? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Okay. That's enough legs. Suitcase. So if I've got the handle here where these hands are, suitcase would be
bit of an upturn at the back, doesn't it? And it's got ridges. I'm gonna lower his hitchhiking arm and lengthen it. You know, I could have just quick drawn a mosquito and it would have looked fine, but it wouldn't have had all the little compositional details the way I wanted it, and probably nobody would have noticed. But better to have better composition. So, thumb actually points back towards his head, which is nice for focal point. Everything points at his head except the secondary area, which is the suitcase, second focal point. I once had a teacher in art school at Art Center in Pasadena. I had a teacher for a design class, and a point that he often made is, yeah, you spend all this time deciding where your focal point is in a composition, but if you want to create a focal point without any composition, just put a postage stamp on your drawing or your painting, and that's what everybody's eye is going to go to, no matter how you compose your art. And you know, there's some truth in that. The postage stamp composition rule, and doing the suitcase with the little travel stamps on it, makes it into a focal point just by the fact that it's got the travel stamps on it. So face is focal point one, suitcase focal point two. So we've got 16 people watching, that's kind of nice. Not a lot of chat going on, but nice to have 16 people watching. I do appreciate if any of you would please follow me, because I need more followers, and I do appreciate the follows. So if you would, thank you so much. We only need two more to get over 200. That would be exciting. Okay, so this is going to come down like that. And this body part starts there on its own. Having this little more curl there is kind of cute. Okay, not quite happy with how the suitcase is hanging. Where do I want the suitcase to be? Again, over here, I've got, that's my mosquito reference. I guess that's all I need. Let's just blow that pup up. And then this is my old SARS cartoon. That's the basis for this. And I'm going to put a similar suitcase with this mosquito. Okay. Back to this. Oh, John Waters, you're mesmerized. What kind words you have. Oh. Thank you. He's on YouTube, which is why you don't see it in the chat. Yeah, this something like a big mosquito should be easier to draw than this. Okay, so let's say that the arm curves more back like that and holds the suitcase more like that. And we can move the suitcase back over here. It's
John Walters. Waters says, honestly, I'm sketching along with you. Are you drawing the same thing that I'm drawing, John? Are you drawing a mosquito, or are you doing your regular work? These dots are kind of interesting. I think it's going to be necessary to do the dots, because it seems that this particular mosquito that does the Zika virus is distinctive for having these dots. I think I'm going to be here for a while with this one, longer than I probably thought. This should be an easy one to draw. It's a very evident, likely Yahtzee cartoon, but haven't seen it in particular. So I suppose you guys are going to go out and search and find another cartoonist who drew this first, huh? If you do that, I'll say, oh. But I'll probably keep drawing it. I don't have a better idea today. Sometimes the obvious Yahtzee idea, like this one, is, well, I should say sometimes, almost always, it's the one that editors really want, which is why it's the Yahtzee cartoon. Okay, I guess that's where I want the suitcase to be. He's covering up what should be interesting leg area. Ah, so John Waters writes, I'm drawing the mosquito. It helps me focus on you and the whole creative process. I drew a boy hitchhiking first, though, too. Well, I did that, too. I have to get a sense of where things go. I'm going to need more sense of weight of the suitcase on his hand. So the top of the suitcase here. The handle. Maybe I need one hand on the handle. If the handle's wrong, if it's big enough to accommodate more than one hand. That makes this leg look wrong. Maybe I use this one for this arm. That leg can go out like that. More complicated to figure out this than I thought. Okay, so the countries I'm going to want on here shall be, let's go with Brazil, Mexico, El Salvador, which has a terrible problem with this. Colombia,
Venezuela. Ecuador. Probably enough. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so let's do some little symbols here. Oh, maybe a little bomb for Venezuela. Venezuela, the bomb. Brazil. Mexico. El Salvador. The only country with the name of Christ, the Savior, El Salvador. Let's give them a little cross. El Salvador. And down here I can have, let's see. Colombia. Oh, I should move over here more, huh? Put you more out of the way of my blue stripe. We've got 18 people watching. You guys should have something more to say. List of dysfunctional countries. Well, not all bad. Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico's pretty dysfunctional now. Costa Rica. So I'm looking at this list of countries from the Centers of Disease Control website. Countries that have the problem with the Zika virus. Bolivia, Barbados, Aruba, Puerto Rico. All right, let's put Puerto Rico in there. Give them a little star. They're American. P-U-R-T-O. I guess that's enough places for him to have been. So the arm holding the suitcase is going to be way up here in the air. Not a comfortable way to carry the suitcase, your arm way up in the air, but it looks like it's right on him. I'm going to give him more
kind of structure to where his legs come out of him. On the actual mosquito, there's very little structure to how the legs come out. They just come out like they were little pins stuck into the body. I'm going to give him a little bit more of a leg nub, so that it makes sense that it's connecting there. Now, next question. It doesn't really have eyes like this. Do I like these eyes? The eyes, being the focal point of this, define the drawing. Going to be a very hairy textural kind of drawing. I gave him fingernails. Okay. Am I satisfied with this? We can do a little bit more with this back end, huh? Bring it down here. That's a little more interesting. And then this can be narrower. Okay, I think I got it. This is my rough sketch. I'm gonna go with this. Let's go to finish on this puppy. I've been drawing this for nearly an hour already. Goodness. So I'm up here grabbing my drawing vellum. Traveling, hitchhiking mosquito. Nobody's followed me today. I would very much appreciate some more follows, folks. Look at all these places where my pencil broke through the paper. I should get better paper. Just actually regular printer bond tab size is what I should be using. Because this gets kind of bumpy with all the places that I broke through it. Okay, quiet folks. John Waters writes, can I send you my drawing later when I'm done with it? Sure, send it to daryl@cagle.com. Okay, now you know his hand on the suitcase here is wrong. Needs to be coming down more weight on it. Right. I've got this right. Now the temptation is to start drawing his face, but I gotta draw from right to left just because I'm left-handed. But you know, everything emanating from here makes me really want to start drawing there. I feel like I need to start drawing the central part first. Let's try that. Now
I'm making up these mosquito anatomy details.
Because the actual details are not that nice.
And they don't have a good structure for how the arms connect.
If you call those arms.
I'm going to need to think here a bit about how to do those white circles that want to appear in him.
You guys are so quiet.
I've been thinking about the future of these broadcasts and that I may want to invite some cartoonists to call me on Skype and have some cartoonist conversations while I do this. All which requires more planning and preparation. See why I wanted to start with the central part. Ginger and Juice says that would be cool. Oh, to see the other cartoonists on Skype chatting with me. Okay, I'll see if they're willing to. That's the kind of thing where it would be helpful to have more of a following, because then I can say to these cartoonists, well, you'll have 100 people watching you. So you've got to coax them into calling. So the following helps. This mosquito arm is in shadow. These guys are really pretty nasty. Okay, they do have a kind of a stripe that goes down the middle.
Again, if you want to take a look at what I'm looking at for my scrap, it is this guy here. And you see what I mean here about the... I'll up a bit. See what I might hear about this stripes going down his back. Kind of go down his wings as well. So he doesn't really have the circles on the top, the circles on the side. Yeah, another thing I'm thinking of doing is taking little clips out of these videos that I'm making and making those into shorter, more focused videos, which would be something I could do if I had a conversation on Skype with a cartoonist while I'm drawing. Not quite sure how the cartoonist is going to feel about me having half my brain concentrating on doing my drawing instead of talking to them. Hey, when I forget to change the scene back, message me and tell me, Daryl, you forgot to change the scene back. Can't see what you're drawing. Okay, he's gonna have, I've got the light source. I always draw the light source coming down this way. So the top of his body area needs to be lighter. Looking okay? He's got some nasty bits. I think that's about where he's gonna be. The nice thing about mosquito anatomy is that it's very forgiving, because who knows exactly what a mosquito looks like. And I got a lot of freedom to make up their anatomy. Freedom that I don't have when I draw people, since you know what people look like.
I give them more joints than they actually have. Well, more defined joints than they actually have. Actually, just a tiny little white speck defines their joints. So, quiet folks, if you haven't followed me, please follow on Twitch or on YouTube. I appreciate it. Yep, some people watching on YouTube. Okay, the wings emanate from behind this gizmo. I like all these bug details. Be fun to design monsters for video games. Make up all these monster details. I think there are people that specialize in just insect designs or lizard skin for the video games. Okay, there's this human hand. Why a human hand? Because I can draw it and you know it's gripping. The handle on the suitcase. Folks are so quiet. Okay, I think that's it. Okay, suitcase. Suitcases are also forgiving, because you don't know exactly what they look like. I've run out of Flint, Michigan water, which is a little bit of a tragedy right here. All right, the secret to doing labels and things. Let's do the lettering first. Venezuela, Mexico, EADOR, El Salvador, TAMALA, Guatemala, Haiti, Puerto Rico, make Colombia upside down, COLOMBIA, My tech guy, Theo, says, wow, 198 followers, that's good. Well, what happens is, once every so often, the nice Twitch people will put me up on the Jumbotron. And when I'm on the Jumbotron, I'll get 40 new followers that day. But when I'm not on the Jumbotron, I get no new followers. Because the people that are watching are already followers. So it's all a crapshoot of whether they put me on the Jumbotron. And I don't quite know the process for that. Every so often they do. Well, four times they did. So four times 40, I got about 160 followers from there putting me on the Jumbotron. And be lovely if they would do that more often. Okay. I need to draw these little labels. I need to draw his hands. There's a lot of stuff going on with the mosquito, you know? So let's make Venezuela into a little bomb. Venezuela is quite the mess. Ecuador. I'll just give Ecuador a shape, although Ecuador is also quite the mess. Brazil, I was going to make into a little triangle. I can do that. Oh, I hear that Cagle.com just had to go into maintenance mode, so all that's showing up there is my video. I have to say that Cagle.com is doing better now. We've got some better defense against the constant hacker attacks. I think the hacker attacks against us are state-sponsored because they're really quite sophisticated, and they have us down quite a bit, although recently we've been doing better. And they're expensive to deal with, which may be the whole point. Is it too expensive? Is it going to make you give up? Okay, Haiti, Guatemala. Guatemala can have a burst. Give Haiti a circle, because that seemed to have room for it. Kid Scoop News, nice to see you here on YouTube. Thanks for coming back. Oh, I was going to give Puerto Rico a little star because it's the United States. Panama. Starting to look like he's been around. So thank you for coming back, Kid Scoop News. I appreciate it. Kid Scoop News, you should go over to Twitch and follow me. That would be nice. Salvador, what shape? Oh, that's a. What was the cross? Because it's El Salvador. My Venezuela's getting a little squeezed. Suitcase is getting done. Should be done pretty soon.
Lily Bean writes, that's looking pretty cool now. Thank you, Lily Bean. Ginger and Juice writes, do you have any pet peeves in regard to cartoonists? Pet peeves. I have lots of pet peeves regarding editors. I like cartoonists. I'm not really annoyed with cartoonists, as I often am with editors and politicians. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. People are going to wonder where that leg is coming from. And I haven't left a space for it, have I? One, two, three, four. Could come from behind. Yeah, let's let it just come from behind. These interesting ridge things going on around this blood sac structure. And they all have these nice big circles on them. Not making that up. Ginger and Juice writes, have you ever placed subliminal messages in your cartoons? You know, just about the only subliminal messages that I think cartoonists do is that some of them put little names of their children, like Hirschfeld or Nick Anderson, or else they'll... They might sometimes do caricatures of people. I was thinking of doing a fundraiser one time that would have a perk of next time I do a crowd scene, I'll do a caricature of you in the crowd scene as your fundraiser perk. Seems like a nice perk. I haven't quite gotten around to that yet. I often do cartoons that lend themselves to that. Like, recently I did that Hillary and Bernie Sanders cartoon with the young women voters all flocking to Bernie. And that would have been a good opportunity for a caricature of a young woman follower, which I would have done had I been a little bit more ambitious in the way that I market everything. But I tend to there's a pet peeve about cartoonists just want to sit and draw their cartoons. They don't want to do their marketing and their streaming and their dealing with anything except drawing their cartoons, and I'm the same way. It's not a business plan going forward for cartoonists to sit and draw their cartoons and hope that the quality of their work is going to make for their success. Quality of work does not lead to success these days. You have to jump out and force yourself to do streaming and things. I think I'm the only cartoonist that's streaming. I have the burden of proof of concept on my shoulders. For the other cartoonists to say, well,
I don't want to do that because Daryl tried it and he's only got 198 followers. That's not going to impress my editor. So basically, I need enough followers that cartoonists will look at my stream and say, if I did that and had people watching and commenting and following like Daryl does, that would be very exciting for my editor and it would make my job secure. So that's the proof of concept. Those other cartoonists aren't going to try unless I demonstrate some value to it. That said, I'm kind of enjoying it. I'm used to working quietly by myself all the time, and now I have some people who seldom comment that I can chat with while I'm drawing. Okay, so 16 very quiet people. Lily Bean writes, glad you do stream. It's very neat to see a cartoon in the making, and Ginger and Juice seconds that. Thank you for the kind words, Lily and Ginger. Needs to be darker, doesn't it? To make the hand and the handle. Pop, it needs to be black under there. Ginger and Juice writes, what's the deal with editors? Are they too picky or what? Editors are too timid. So what we're seeing now is most of the pressure on newspapers has been that they lost their advertisers. So you have Craigslist that took over the classified ads and all of these help wanted sites that have taken away the help wanted ads, real estate sites that take away the real estate advertising dollars. So, and department stores down the tubes that used to be biggest advertisers in newspapers, department stores and car dealerships, they're all going different directions with their marketing now. And that has taken the income away from newspapers. So all you hear about all this death of newspaper stuff, and people think that means that people just don't read newspapers anymore. It is not that. There has been some drop in, a good deal of drop in readership for newspapers, but nothing like would cause the problems newspapers have, because the newspapers have lost their revenue to other advertising media. So editors, who are little cogs in the wheel, the editorial page editors that I work with. Oh, John Waters Jr. switched over to Twitch. See how you like it so far? It's great. Well, good. Nice to see you over here, John. You know, YouTube, I tend not to get I tend not to get much of a live audience there. With three people watching on YouTube. The place to build an audience is on Twitch. And I think probably just because they'll put me on the Jumbotron every so often. And YouTube is more for archiving the cartoons. And it's nice to have the stream go over there because it leaves a nice cartoon file there behind it. But don't see your comments showing up on my screen here. So, hey, John Waters Jr., be sure to follow me on Twitch. I would appreciate it. I need 2 followers to get over 200. It seems like an important milestone. Oh, so talking about editors. So what editors tend to do is they tend to get timid. So when the old lady sees something that bothers her and writes a letter and says, I'm going to cancel my subscription to your newspaper. Editors freak out, well, and out of proportion to how much one person writing an angry letter should make them freak out. And so the editors tend to pick cartoons that are just nice little jokes that don't express any opinion and that nobody's going to disagree with. Kind of like today's Mosquito cartoon, because mosquitoes are bad guys for everybody. Nobody is going to say, your cartoon is unfair to mosquitoes. So, kind of cartoon that editors like. But draw something that expresses a worthwhile opinion, worthwhile in the respect that you're saying something that some people disagree with, so that some people are going to get angry with you, which are really what cartoonists want to do. And those cartoons don't get reprinted much because they want Jay Leno jokes that don't express any opinion, just have a hitchhiking mosquito. And so it's the timid editors that bother me. And they're more and more timid as time goes by. And their jobs are more threatened, and they worry more about the newspapers losing their money. It's a plague of timid editors. That's my diatribe. So we certainly noticed that in our cartoon stats. I can predict which cartoons are going to do well. And of course the ones that get reprinted the most are the ones that are funny and drawn well and express no controversial opinion whatsoever. I think the cartoons that editors like most are celebrity schadenfreude cartoons, where the rich celebrity makes a mistake, particularly a sexual mistake. That's what the editors like cartoons about. Ginger and Juice writes, what's been your favorite job in your field so far? Well, I've basically had 2 careers. One as a, well, 3 careers. One as an illustrator, one as a toy inventor designer, and one as an editorial cartoonist. And I enjoy the editorial cartooning the best. I have the best job in the world. And particularly since I own the syndicate, the little business that distributes the cartoons, and I don't have any editor since MSNBC dumped me. then I can draw what I want. No editor. I still have clients that I have to deal with, all the newspapers, but you know, when you got 850 clients, you don't have to kowtow to anybody. Do what you want. They want to quit because they don't like a cartoon, which happens. They're one out of 850, so I don't have to worry too much about them. Although I do love my clients, and I don't want you guys to quit, in case you're watching. And when I talk about editors being timid and terrible, if you're an editor watching, just know that it's not you I'm talking about, it's those other editors. So, favorite job, Ginger and Juice, is just what I'm doing. I have been lucky enough to end up in the place where I like being. I would like it if I could get a bigger audience for the streams and make more of an investment in the streaming. It's actually been pretty difficult to get the streaming figured out. My phone is ringing. Ugh. It's a cartoonist who I need to speak with, but I'm doing my stream and I have to call him back. Okay, let's jump up to his wings. Still 16 people watching. Quiet 16 people. If not for Ginger and Juice, I'd have little to say. Okay, the wings need to come out of his back. Wing. Yeah, it's all the drawbacks to the streaming are that you have to keep a schedule and you have to commit to finishing the drawing once you start it in the same session because people want to see some conclusion. Sometimes I would keep two or three cartoons on the table at a time and just work on the one that had inspired me most and let the other one sit for a while, and then sometimes some cartoons would not get finished because I'd lose interest in them. That is not how you can approach cartooning if you're streaming. This wing kind of looks like a leaf, doesn't it? I wonder if that's a mistake. A leaf or a feather. Oh, Ginger and Juice, I appreciate the questions. I would like to get more questions from people. But sure, go ahead. Ask all the questions you like. I've noticed that when there are particular things I draw, I can't talk because whatever mental process I'm using to draw that particular thing uses the same friggin' brain cells as talking. And every so often I'll run across something like that that makes me shut up. And I notice most of the cartoonists that I see, well, most of the artists that I see on Twitch Creative are not as talkative as I would like for them to be. They sit quietly or they play music. And it's It's one thing I don't like is listening to their music. That's a sure way to get you to turn the audio off on a stream, is the guy's not talking. But I figure if I just talk, I don't play music, and I talk fairly consistently, and if I can have something worthwhile to say, which means I need some more questions, then and you can play your own music and leave my audio on. It's a bid to leave the audio on, have more conversation. Which sometimes comes into conflict with that particular batch of brain cells. And I find that it's an acquired skill, this constantly yammering when you have nothing to say. It makes me understand the politicians constantly yammering with nothing to say a little bit better. Okay. Oh, we're picking up a few people. Oh, I got one person to follow! John Waters Jr. John, you're my one follower today. Thank you so much. That's very nice of you. You have the distinction of being the one follower today. Follower number 199, putting me right up on the edge of making the odometer turn over with 200 followers. Let's see if that'll happen. You should have gotten a little following animation. I don't look at the screen to see what's happening. I'm looking where I'm drawing. Okay. Looking mosquito-y, huh? Ginger and Juice writes, what are your thoughts on Charlie Hebdo deal? Well, it's a big subject for all the cartoonists, but I go to the conventions in France, and a couple of guys that were murdered at Charlie Hebdo were convention friends of mine from France that I would see year after year and have continuing conversations with, and they were just lovely guys. And it's really very sad. I understand all the free speech kinds of arguments that we need to make, and you know, the red lines kind of arguments, where are your red lines, but all of that kind of pales when you know the guys and think of it on a personal basis. So I'd say rather than the issues it raises, for me it's just a sad personal thing. And it has certainly changed the profession. And those guys were very nice, thoughtful, important cartoonists in France. They were stars. The ones I knew, Tignu and Walensky. I knew Walensky because he would come to the convention in Saint-Just-le-Martel, France, that I go to regularly. And so we could have conversations. Just quite a lovely gentleman. If you look at my darylcagle.com site, you can search Walensky and go back, and I have a nice post about the memorial that the Saint-Just convention put up for Walensky. And then Tignu, I got to know when we did a cartoonist trip to Colombia a few years ago. He was one of the French cartoonists on the trip. It was a Plan 2 cartooning for peace trip. And he was active in cartooning for peace, and So I met him on a couple of Cartooning for Peace trips, and they tend to be long trips, so you get to have nice conversations with everybody. And Tignu was just a lovely, beloved guy. Terrible tragedy for Cartooning on a personal level, which is personal level is what remains with me. I'm tired of arguing the politics of it. The Gary Trudeau kind of blame the victim stuff. Just tired of that. I still just treat it as a matter for grieving. One thing kind of interesting, I'll tell you an interesting story. So when this stuff was raging, got a call from the producers at Fox and Friends. They wanted me to come on the air, talk about the issue of whether the cartoonists are to blame for bringing the attacks on themselves. And I did a pre-interview with them where I said I thought it was terrible that they talked that way. And so they decided to schedule somebody else rather than have me come on and complain about them directly to them. Blame the victims, bastards. So that's why you didn't see me on Fox and Friends. Otherwise, I kind of like Fox. They run Cagle Cartoons. They're good customers. And I do find Fox News Channel more entertaining than MSNBC or CNN. That said, their blame the victims news coverage of Charlie Hebdo massacre was crummy. You know, you don't have to have talking heads on two sides of an issue for everything. Sometimes you can avoid that and take the high road. So ultimately, no speech is justification for murder. So you got me ranting on Charlie Hebdo, huh? I mean, I've been drawing here for, John Waters Jr. says, good for you, stick up for the victims in that context. Well, I wasn't. If I had been smarter about it, I would have just done the regular talking head thing in my pre-interview and gone on Fox and Friends and then assailed them for their blame the victim crap. But I was not terribly interested in media opinions, and I was still grieving the death of my friends. So perhaps if I had it to do over again, I would have been a little more diplomatic with my pre-interview. Rebel YYY asks, can you draw realistic? Yeah. When I first started off, I started off as an illustrator, and I worked for like 15 years with Jim Henson's Muppets. But I had intended to be a realistic illustrator before I really hooked up with the Muppets and the cartooning jobs after I moved to New York. And I had studied under a Danish illustrator named Harry Nordstrand, who drew castles and sunsets and kissing couples for the romantic books. And you know, at that time, the romantic books were just doing crazy well, and he was having a heck of a career doing romance. And that's actually what I thought I was going to do. I went to New York with a portfolio full of people kissing in front of castles. Rebel YYY said, okay, if I pay you, can you draw a stone-faced lion for my next forearm tattoo? You have a picture. How can you have a picture before I've drawn something? Sure, give me a link to a picture in chat and I'll take a look. I have had other cartoonists send me photographs of tattoos that people have done of cartoons of theirs. And it's funny, kind of creepy to have somebody take your cartoon and put it on their flesh. The whole notion of tattoos is a crazy generational thing to me. I'm older than the Twitch audience, and so I tend not to be the likely tattoo customer. No tattoos for me. My cartoonist journalist daughter Susie gets tattoos, which disturbs me, and I say, don't get tattoos, and she says, oh Dad, you're so old. So, I did this thing with the National Cartoonist Society where we go to military hospitals and draw for the wounded warriors, which is kind of nice. Anyway, so I'm at this Marine Rehabilitation Center. These guys that were injured in Afghanistan, they're rehabilitating, and they've all got tattoos. You know, they're Marines, they're very tattooed, and there are themes that you notice. Lots of skeletons, lots of skeleton characters, because they're, you know, big, tough, watch out for us, death to you bad guys kind of guys. So I would ask these Marines, so you've got this big skeleton character on your arm. Tell me about him. Who is he? The Marine would say, I don't know. Just a skull. And I'd say, well, he's there on your arm. You must know something about him. Does he have a name? No, just a skull. Does he have a story behind him? No, I just liked it. Well, tell me something more about him as a character, and I'll draw a cartoon for you with your tattoo character in your cartoon. Oh, yeah, that's great. They like the tattoo character in the cartoon, but they can't tell me anything about his personality. They have never thought of him having a name. Don't know anything about his backstory. You know, big friggin' skeleton guy holding a machine gun on your arm, on your chest, and you haven't thought a thing about what his name is or what's his motivation. You know, an actor gets a job. First thing he asks is, what's my character's motivation? Not so when a Marine gets a tattoo. The Marine puts no thought into the character or his motivation of his tattoo, which I thought was interesting. It's the first question I would ask. Who is this skeleton? Why do you choose to put him on your upper arm? What is his motivation? No answers to any of these questions.
Okay, Rebel YYY has posted his link. Ginger and Juice writes, watched a documentary about Charles M. Schulz a couple years ago. Have you seen it? I don't remember, but I'm a big Charles M. Schulz fan. Okay, let's look at Rebels. Lion. Open up link. A new window. Well, it's a nice standard looking lion. So why do you want a lion tattoo, Rebel YYY? For what purpose? And why squinty eyes? Is it bright sunlight where the lion is? Oh, well, the ground here kind of leads you to want to sign your name there, doesn't it? So, Cagle.com. And the reason I signed my cartoons DarylCagle.com is that I also put a little URL into them. Here it'll be politicalcartoons.com. And having two URLs is kind of a pushing editors a little harder than I think they should be pushed. So if I make my signature into a URL, then I can argue, well, that's really my signature. It's not really two URLs. So why the lion, Rebel YYY? What's his name? What's his motivation? What's your reason for putting him on your body part? What body part will he be on? What's he doing? What is your relationship with lions? Some of the bumps in this arm are coming about because of my tearing the paper underneath it when I was doing the rough sketch. So, serendipitous details. Rebel writes, yes, and long story, but I'm a police officer and I'd like to have something to look at every day that indicates courage. So you don't want it to be the cowardly lion. I guess the cowardly lion finally got courage. We're not a police officer lion. On your inner forearm, so that you can have your arm down and people won't know that you've got a courageous lion there unless your arms are up. And it's the bad guys whose arms should be up, not the police officer. So inner forearm, I guess that makes sense, huh? What city are you a policeman in, Rebel YYY? And how much of the lion is there going to be? Is this going to be a full body? If so, is he wearing any clothes? Does he have a policeman's hat?
So I think that if you went to any tattoo parlor with this photo of a lion and said, give me a lion head on the inside of my upper arm, that they would all say that that's all the direction they need. So if you want me to do something about a lion, it should be more something that a cartoonist did, something that has some kind of statement more than convert the photo into line art using your wrist. That's a term that illustrators hear a lot. The illustrator's the wrist, because the art director knows exactly what he wants, doesn't want you to think about anything, just wants to give you the solution and have you have your unique wrist put your drawing spin on it. And of course cartoonists hate that, because we want to think and we want to draw what we think. So having a completed face with fur on the side. I think he needs a policeman's hat and a policeman's shirt. Otherwise, there's no reason for you to have him. No reason for you to have a cartoonist do anything for you. You get a photograph and a tattoo artist, you're fine. But if you're doing a lion policeman, that's something different. Like a Marine putting a skeleton on his arm. Why? Well, everybody else puts skeletons on their arms. And the Marines? That's not a good answer. It also strikes me as interesting that they want skeletons who you would think would be the skeletons you would think would be the end result of the bad guy. So he's the suffering bad guy who ended up as a skeleton. But no, it's the Marine that's the skeleton. So Rebel YYY says, never mind, I was going to pay you. Mine has meaning. Okay, well, I'm sorry to be disappointing, Rebel. Why? But if you've got a photograph and you just want to translate a photograph, I don't think you need a cartoonist. Just go to the tattoo parlor. But if you've got a lion that's got some character and story, that would make it more interesting to have a cartoonist. Lily Bean writes, Rebel, I think he's saying that as a cartoonist it wouldn't come across as the more realistic image you seem to want. Rebel YYY writes, okay, never mind. Funky Monkey writes, drawing has developed a lot. Oh, you must have walked away for a minute. Thank you. Okay, let's do his hands. Little Eiffel. Hi, Daryl. Great drawing. Is this creature intended to represent a particular nationality or ethnicity? I don't know. This is the mosquito that carries the Zika virus, and he does it mostly in South America. Oh, well, and the Caribbean and Mexico. So I suppose he's a Brazilian mosquito, but he's real. His nationality, I think, is more mosquito than any particular country. So let's just call him a representative of Mosquitopia. I think that's what a mosquito's hand looks like. Kid Scoop News writes, did a lot of papers run the Supreme Court cartoon you did last week? I showed you my local newspaper ran it, but you know, newspapers don't report to me on what they do. I got a couple angry comments from it from people who seem to be thinking that I should have drawn a nicer obituary cartoon about Scalia. And this really wasn't an obituary cartoon. Here, you want to see my cartoon in the newspaper again? This is yesterday's local newspaper. This is my Supreme Court cartoon in yesterday's local newspaper, which is very nice. I like to see my cartoons in my local newspaper. Makes me feel like I'm a part of the world. Lily Bean writes, they don't have to notify you if they run it. That is right. They don't. Newspapers subscribe to the service, and part of the service, they can just go into the website and get what they want from me or the other cartoonists in my group. And they don't notify us. And they don't pay very much. And they pay a low weekly fee for use of everything, for which they do not have to report. Okay, there's his three hands. I'm not sure I like them. I think it's this middle one I don't like. You know, I'm not writing Zika on him anywhere. I'm just presuming people know that he's a Zika mosquito. Never occurred to me to have to write Zika on him. Is it apparent that he's the Zika mosquito without having the word Zika in the cartoon? I ask because of Little Eiffel's comment about the creature, because it seems that Little Eiffel did not draw the conclusion that he was the Zika mosquito. Could put the word Zika on him somewhere. Lily Bean, can you put Zika on his wing? I would know what it is, but I've read about Zika. You know, if I make this middle part dark, and it is dark, I could write Zika on here, reverse it out in Photoshop. I'll think about doing that when I color it. I haven't put that much thought into the Zika label. Baggage tag with his name Zika, Lily Bean suggests. It's kind of small. Well, I guess I could make a baggage tag any size I want. Draws the eye away. I think I would put Zika right here on his back if I decide to have a label. When I finish the line art here, I'm going to take a break for a few minutes. I'll put the timer back up in the window, and I'll ask you guys not to go away. If you want to keep watching, I will come back and color it, which will probably take more than another hour. I'm already 2 hours into this thing. Coloring's going to take about an hour, or hour and a half, maybe an hour. Virus will travel, writes Dawifa. Nice to see you here, Dawifa. Oh, I got one more follower, but I guess somebody unfollowed. Now I'm back down to 198. So if you're watching, please follow. I'd love to get over that 200 number, which seems to be a barrier. Putting in little bits of crud. The wings here look like two individual feathers, don't they? I didn't think much about that. Wings would have more of a pattern of veins and arteries, I guess. Well, I think I might be done. He needs to be having a little bit of motion. About all the motion he needs. Is that done? Do I want to have a little more crap going on in the background? Ginger and juice off to the gas station. Cartoonist documentaries. I'll take a look. I saw the one on the New Yorker. That was very nice. And there's one on the comic strips that's also very nice. Okay, I think I'm ready to go to scanning this. So scanning this is not a process that lends itself to streaming. So what I'm going to do is set my timer for a 15-minute break, at which I will scan and pour myself a new glass of water and run to the bathroom. Okay, very good. Thank you, Ginger and Juice. I'll take a look. There he is, the mosquito, soon to be colored. And so, let's go over here, and we'll set my timer for 15 minutes. So I'm going to head out for 15 minutes, and then I shall return, and I will color this thing in Photoshop. So if you're watching, please don't go away. I appreciate it, and thank you so much. And
I'm sorry, folks. I'm going to have to restart my computer to get Photoshop to open. It is, it's given me trouble. It's refusing. So it's going to take me a few minutes to come back. I apologize for that. Know that I'm right here and ready to come back as soon as I can get computer rebooted and Photoshop working. So